two different sides of the coin, and I mean that in terms of how their decks function. Lucas Singh, back here in Top Cut, fell just short at Indianapolis, bubbling out at ninth place. He took that redemption and went full force into our top eight, looking to get that first regional win in the Masters division. And he has had quite a stellar season. Look at that, multiple top 16s, that top four where he fell just short to Control. But he has pivoted over. Maybe his biggest demon, the thing that took him out of Vancouver, he has now converted over to that, playing this Pidgeot Control deck. And the Ace spec has been a big help to this deck, that Hero's Cape, allowing whatever Pokemon you put it onto to essentially be unknockoutable. You cannot knock out whatever is attached to it. I know it says just 100 more HP, but you could pretty much just say you cannot touch this thing.
I'm pretty sure you just invented the word unknockoutable.
I'm an innovator, what can I say?
All right, now let's take a look at Nico's accomplishments here. The top performing Future Box player has already this season a top 16 at Portland and had a previous top 16 at Dallas Regionals and a top 32 at Costa Mesa. So very impressive list of accolades as well, with another one to add to that list with this top eight and possibly better.
And I hear he's got some supporters out in the crowd, some people cheering him on. Okay, may have a little bit of a crowd favorite, but it's not going to be very easy for Lucas, especially when you're facing down Iron Hands EX, boosted by Iron Crown's Cobalt Command ability. Pidgeot EX, the main center card of Lucas's deck, is going to be under threat, under fire, if Ampu very much can take a whopping three prize cards versus a Pidgeot EX.
Yeah, it's going to be essentially a Pidgeot VMAX at this point with giving up that extra
Don't
prize.
Don't scare me. Don't bring me back, Pablo, please.
Now, it's really cool to see that Nico has qualified for Worlds after this placement. So no matter what happened, he is in the big party as we see the prizes. That Mowell, all right, could be very, very key for Lucas, as it's the only way he has to trap. And I don't see any way to switch in Nico's list here.
Yeah, usually you'll sometimes see one copy of a switch cart, like I mentioned. But there is that Prime Catcher. Let's not forget about Prime Catcher. That pink A-spec is going to be the key card in this matchup between both of our competitors. The stage is set. It feels like we're on a TV show here in Los Angeles. Are we sure we're not on a movie set here? The plot is getting thick. We are getting towards our season finale. And here we go. Let's get into it. Top eight at the final regional championship. Lucas starting things off and does open with that one copy, or rather playing two of them. But still, great card to open with. Buddy Buddy Poffin immediately can get out these Pixie Pokemon, and we'll check to see what is available and what is in the prize cards.
Now that Mimikyu could be a problem for Nico down the line, but he does have that answer off Mirahidon. The thing is, like, you know you're up against some sort of control deck. I'm not sure how much information Nico has on Lucas's list at this point in time, but any extra Iron Crown you end up benching could be a liability, because those are the prime Pokemon that Lucas will want to trap with that Mowell. And if Nico is expecting a Snorlax, perhaps, he's going to be very, very cautious. So we're going to see an interesting dynamic between the Mimikyu, the Mirahidon aggression, how Nico manages his bench. And we just saw him win on stream in the previous round, right? Mm-hmm. So it'll be interesting to see how Nico navigates this one.
Let's not forget about those two Iron Bundle as well. It's a Pokemon that can have a lot of use of pivoting out, maybe something like a Snorlax or a wall that sort of sits in the active. But, I mean, looking at this list, there is actually no Snorlax in this list here for Lucas. So, yeah, that Mawile being prized, definitely a big card to think about. But sometimes with how powerful Charizard is, sometimes if you can just get a single Charizard EX up when your opponent's taken a few prize cards, that's kind of all you need to just start really rolling through your opponent's Pokemon.
Yeah, Lucas could definitely go behind quite a bit and then go in with an Iono, knockouts with back-to-back-to-back Charizard, and take over the game, because there's no way for Nico to take a one-hit KO on that. So Lucas has that Pidgeot control deck, but also has the possibility to be aggressive with the Charizard, with the Radiant Charizard, with the Entei as well. So this is going to be super, super interesting to see how it plans out.
And Nico will be going second. And okay, this is where things get scary. We've got some electric generators in the hand, and the first one hits double lightning energy. Uh-oh, if you're Lucas here, you've got to be worrying a little bit, thinking, What happens if my opponent can maybe knock this Charmander out on the first turn? That Iron Bundle even, though you wouldn't be knocking out the Charmander specifically, a turn one amp you very much would be a super electric start to this first game.
Yeah, now there's no double turbo here, but we do see the next electric generator, and there's two more energies. Wow.
Okay, and you see Lucas really like, come on, this is how I'm going to open my top eight match after playing all those Swiss rounds, and it is going picture perfect, film perfect, movie perfect for Nico. He's getting everything he wants. He is trying to embody that main character energy here in top eight.
Now, does go for the attachment on the active, does know that there's a possibility that the Iron Crown gets trapped, already has the tool to retreat, but there's no way to get this Mimikyu out of the active spot with those Iron Bundles, so no aggression despite the picture-perfect start.
Yeah, picture-perfect, except there's no other Pokemon and no supporter card, just two energy cards and that future booster capsule. That's really all you can have at this point, with that Mimikyu sitting there. Both of these Pokemon, for the time being, will be unable to really put on any sort of aggression. I mean, you can use the twin shuttles on the Iron Crowns. That can get through the Mimikyu, but that's really all that you have access to, as Lucas does open with this Ultra Ball. So this hand, though, looking very weak. So you've got to wonder here, what is the selection? You could grab something like Lumineon, and actually, if there is a Lumineon in this deck, which there is, that could get this Pidgeot set up because of that Forest Seal Stone plus Arvin combination.
Yep, as long as the Forest Stone is available, which it is, we're going to see Pidgeot hit the field and allow Lucas to start controlling, right? Mm-hmm. But it feels like right now Lucas does have Nico under control in that regard. I wonder if Lucas is going to be aggressively going for that Mawile, depending on how much information he has on Nico's deck and Nico's outs to that possibility. But first, we need the Pidgeot.
So we'll grab the Arvin to the hand. And now the choice. Is there any reason to just not go for this? You've always got to think, if my opponent's holding on to a boss or can find a way to gust up this Pidgeot, if the one card that I grab is really not going to make too big of a difference. But you kind of at the same time really have to just think to yourself, no matter what I do, I've got to start putting it together some strategy. And if I'm not putting Pidgeot into play, it's going to make it a lot harder to get that done.
Now, I did see Lucas eye up the Cleffa, put it at the front of the deck, so that might be the card he quick searches for to replenish resources. He does have an energy to retreat the Mimikyu. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I mean, as you mentioned, Lucas has now the Lumineon on the bench, will have a Pidgeot as well, and with Amp you very much, yeah, you could easily win in two attacks because of that extra prize effect. So Lucas is going to need to be very, very careful with that.
And does have plenty of rare candy, three copies of that card. So with this, can maybe find a way to fill the hand up a little bit. I think the question here for Lucas is, do you just grab the Cleffa itself, or do you grab Nestaball because it's a card that you don't want to find off Grasping Draw? I feel like most players would just go straight for the Cleffa, but Lucas understands this next turn is going to be a big one, especially if my opponent can move this Iron Crowns out of the active and take that turn two, amp you very much to take two prize cards.
Yeah, Nico does already have that tool to retreat, but I wonder what Nico's going to top there, because, like, eventually you need a way to deal with that Mimikyu, right? So even though you're off to a good start, that's going to make you more vulnerable to Iono and also more vulnerable to the Charizard that's going to happen eventually.
Wow, top deck professor's research. That is big for Nico. That will keep him in a much more reasonable spot in this game. Would have really loved to see something like Boss's Orders that first or second turn, but you've got to take what you could get. Research, not a bad way to start things off. And if Nico chooses to here, could take two prize cards with Amp you very much. See what these seven cards grant. There is a Nest Ball in the hand. Looks like another Iron Hands EX. And this game for Nico, a lot of it is going to be slowly throughout the game trying to understand how Lucas has built this deck. Are there cards like Snorlax in this deck? Are there things like Mawile? What ways does my opponent have to shut off my Amp you very much? And what are my opponent's win conditions? Identifying those as quickly as possible will get you closer to creating a winning strategy in this game.
Now, it seems like Nico's going to take his time. This is his first deck search. He hasn't been able to see what he prized, what resources he has access to. So, did see him put all those Pokemon at the very front. Checks for that Prime Catcher, which is very essential. The Lost Vacuum is also very essential to get rid of Heroescape, get rid of Defiance Vest. So, being very thorough, which I think is very, very important to make sure every move you make is completely calculated and perfect.
So it will just be that Maridon going onto the bench. And now comes the question here. Is there a world where you don't want to take two prize cards this turn to maybe put yourself out of range for a Charizard EX knockout? But it's not quite safe to put yourself at that range because we did see Lucas hold on to that Defiance Band, which with one prize card taken would put this Iron Hands at 240 damage applied and knock it out.
Yeah, so they're never truly safe. Now, we are going to see the retreat. I wonder what Nico is planning with this extra Iron Hand at this point in time. It's a prime target to be trapped, right, in the active. It's a very big energy hog, and we do have the Charizard EX in play, so we could just see a quick search for Rare Candy Charizard, and all of a sudden, Pidgeot Control becomes a Charizard EX deck.
Yeah, who needs that? I mean, you could just take away all the control aspects and just play like a Charizard EX deck, and that seems to be exactly what Lucas is looking for. Arvin can grab not only the Rare Candy, but also that Hero's Cape, and now this game could just completely shift into protecting the way everything plays out. It looks like Nico only took the one prize card, so maybe trying to play around the Defiance Band, but you've got to expect that in these control decks. And now, what was just taking one prize card, sure, after this turn, you'll go back to only Burning Darkness dealing 210 damage, but those Iron Crowns EX on the bench, they can also be one hit knocked out by that Charizard.
Yep, they're going to be in full range with a Dark type weakness, and yeah, things are not looking good here for Nico. We'll have two energies in play, but now it's not about dealing with Mimikyu. It's about dealing with this humongous Charizard EX.
So Lucas finding exactly what he wants on this turn. And we'll even just go back in and going to play a Palpad just to put that boss's orders back in. Can also put in that Arvin, but I feel like both or none would be good. The boss, definitely priority number one, because even if Nico doesn't take prize cards, that Iron Crown's on the bench, it is in range, and then from there, eventually, you're just going to be able to finish off the game with something like Radiant Charizard. What an excellent few turns here for Lucas. Has set up perfectly and has put pressure and is going to wipe out this Iron Hands EX with all four energies on it and put the tempo into his court.
Now we're going to see the heavy ball, so even unlocking the Mowile for the potential to switch back into control mode and be able to trap something with Mowile. However, choosing the Radiant Charizard, so just choosing to go for aggression, right? Knows that Charizard has so much HP, there's nothing threatening it on Nico's side of the board. And I think this is one of the reasons why we hadn't seen too much Future Box, because Charizard is so popular, right? Charizard has been dropping off in popularity, hasn't been getting those big results anymore. But here it is, Pidgeot with the 1-1 Charizard line is still putting in the work and is still a big threat for Iron Hands.
Turn three, Burning Darkness. Lucas taking advantage into his hands, going to four prize cards. And now for Nico, you're staring down a Charizard EX. If you bring up this Maridon, just going to get knocked out in return. So what do you do from here? You know your opponent also has access to Radiant Charizard, so if you're even able to manage to knock it out, then that means something like Magma Basin and an attachment, or just an attachment next turn to that Charizard threatens another two prize card mapping here for Lucas. Things are looking grim immediately for Nico, especially after this Iron Hands has been knocked out.
Now, Nico does have a counter catcher in his hand. Could take down the Mimikyu, as he also has the tool. Could take down the Pidgey, but then that just means this Charizard takes down the Iron Hands very easily, right? As we did see Lucas put back the boss's orders. So Nico against the ropes at this point.
So we'll still play things out. Gonna give it his best shot. We'll see the Techno Radar. Find some more of these future Pokemon. We haven't seen anything like the Iron Bundle come down just yet. I think it's just debating what card do I want to discard at this point. I think we're thinking about maybe getting rid of this future booster capsule. I think that will be the choice. Just going to get rid of that. Search out for two more future Pokemon. And it looks like it will be the Iron Hands and one more choice. You maybe got to continue to think about, okay, if my opponent is going with this route in this matchup, if they're only going with aggression, am I safe to just start benching Iron Crowns if it looks like there's not a reasonable way for them to maybe trap them?
Yeah, but I mean, not trapping is just not going to be enough, right? Because if you start taking prizes, the Charizard EX just becomes better and better. And if you don't, right, however much damage Maridon does to this Charizard, it's not really going to set up a two-hit KO with Iron Hands. It's going to be a three-hit KO. So things are looking a little bit grim at this point in time.
Yep, so we're just confirming everything is on par. Energy onto this Maridon. So the question now, what do you go after with this counter catcher? I feel like maybe now is just the best opportunity to go after the Mimikyu. Nope, we're just going to go after the Pidgey. So that will be taken out with the peak acceleration attack. And yeah, like you said, I mean, Lucas hasn't even played that lost vacuum yet. So if you're putting yourself in a position, you're going to even things up. And from here, it just gets so tough. There's too many two-prize Pokemon on the bench. Lucas still has that boss's orders. He can potentially even use it again with the second copy of Palpad that is still available.
Yeah.
So we're just going to really come down to this. Nico will still go down to just four prize cards left. But even then, we'll have to put together two big knockout turns. So let's see what Lucas has in hand. It's going to be a lot easier, though, thanks to Quick Search.
Now, Nico also knows that the Radiant Charizard is available, so Lucas has all the tools to just pretend to be a Charizard deck and take over this game. Nico, at best, can take down two more Pokemon, right, to win this game. Lucas will need that Boss's Orders, potentially back-to-back Boss's Orders, but it's not like the Maridon is really threatening you too much either, so I think Lucas has a big advantage. We do see him grab that Boss's Orders. You gotta go after that Iron Hands, right?
Yeah, it would move the energy to the other Iron Hands, so maybe there's a world where you just knock out the Iron Crowns, really remove that damage. It does have that Psychic attached to it, so there's no threat maybe down the line. Most Iron Crowns lists are only playing that one Psychic energy, so that way you don't maybe allow your opponent to move that energy onto the Iron Crowns. I feel like that is also an okay option to go for. Whole purpose is, even if Nico wants to use Ampu very much next turn, he's going to have to play one of those two remaining electric generators to do so.
Now, Lucas trying to thin his deck as much as possible. People going crazy about the Rotom V hitting the
That's
hand.
That's my boy right there. I knew the people loved him, you know. We just had to really get him on the stage at a big moment. And then, finally, the support would come out for him. Thank you guys for really supporting him. I appreciate that.
And now we do see more deck thinning. Pidgeot hitting the hand. No backup Pidgey to be able to set up two Pidgeots. But at this point, does it even matter? The only Pokemon that can KO Pidgeot is Iron Hands. If there's an Iron Hands in the active, then Charizard is just going to have a field day.
Now Lucas is thinking, what do I even bring up here? Doesn't necessarily matter. I think you just want to take those energies out of play off the Iron Crowns. Just take the knockout for now. Don't play into the heavy baton, but at the same time, it's kind of very, very minimal in terms of difference, but it's actually just going to go after the clean Iron Hands. What do you think about this play, Pablo?
I mean, there's generally very little difference between one or the other, but I really would have liked him to see just exhaust the heavy baton option, right? It's better to have an Iron Hands with two energy and no heavy baton than an Iron Hands with two energy and the heavy baton.
Well, does it even matter at this spot if you're going to just take two more prizes to win the game?
It doesn't. I'm generally trying to be thorough with the details, but
I got you.
Lucas, one knockout away, the Maridon could do 80 damage max unless more Iron Crowns hit the board. And that's what I was going to say. I actually liked hitting the Iron Crown because the only universe where Nico has a chance here is if the Maridon sets up a two-hit KO and then you knock out with Iron Hands and somehow Lucas doesn't have a response. But because he has another turn to just attach a fire to the Radiant Charizard, the Maridon's just not good enough to be useful here. And Lucas can also just attack twice to win the game. So I think we should be heading to a game two very soon here, Ethan.
Yeah, if there's no way to take a prize card this turn, even if you're setting up for a three-prize Ampu very much, because Nico only took that one prize, trying to play around Charizard EX response KOing, it may come back to bite him a little bit. So we'll still play this game out. That is sort of the benefit of playing in this best of three 75-minute situation. And all the credit to him, I think Nico should be playing out these games because the more time that's burnt off the clock, I feel like the better it will be for a deck like his that eventually maybe want to be a little bit more aggressive if we go to a super late game three.
Yeah, but as you mentioned, that key card, that key prize card that Nico chose not to take, right? If Nico was at three prize cards, he could possibly be one boss away from knocking out the Lumineer or the Prime Catcher, right? Prime Catcher plus Electric Generator, knocking out Lumineer, knocking out Pidgeot could get him the last three prizes. But because he chose not to take that first prize card, trying to respect the Charizard, look, he has Counter Catcher and Electric Generator in hand, so that one prize card that he chose not to take is now being very, very costly.
Yeah, knockout on Lumineon at this point would just close the game out.
Yeah.
So that's advice you've got to give yourself for the next game. Continue to think about it. Chose to just dig deep with research there, not play the Iono, so Lucas will sit on a few more cards. And even for Nico in the spot, I don't know if I would even grab Iron Bundle at this spot. It's just information that I'm not sure is quite relevant at this spot. And maybe Lucas didn't know that there were multiple copies or even one copy here. Now, if there was a different situation here where there was just three prize cards remaining,
yeah,
that could have been a make or break.
Huge. Yeah,
but we're in a different universe. It's not the same timeline we're in here, Pablo.
Yep. That would have been a make or break, as you mentioned. Unfortunately, not going to be the case this time around. Now, does play the counter catcher to knock out the Mimikyu. So now he is in that spot, and he doesn't know how many boss's orders Lucas plays, but perhaps if there's only one copy, which is right here, as we can see, maybe, just maybe, a prime catcher plus boss KO now on Luminion or Pidgeot is the way Nico wins this game.
Yeah, I've sort of changed my mind on this a little bit here, Pablo. Nico's going to go down to just four prize cards, or three prize cards left.
Yeah.
And even if Lucas plays something like Penny, because he didn't target that Iron Crowns, the way the boosted damage works, it will be enough to knock out Pidgeot EX. Of course, a second one did come down, so it's not as relevant. But hold on here. I think we may have counted Nico out a little bit too early. That Iron Hands is fully powered up. Yes, Penny is great, but the way that this thing works out, you've got to make sure your Pidgeot is not getting knocked out. So we've got to check the math. We haven't seen the Hero's Cape come down yet. So if
True.
The Hero's Cape comes down onto Pidgeot EX, that would put it to 380 HP, which means that it would have to be 190 damage amp you very much. If there was a booster capsule, it would just still be short because it would be doing only 360. So there it is. That's a big card, but let's not forget, there is a card Nico is playing, that Lost Vacuum. We haven't seen it get played yet. That's going to be a big key card.
Yep, Lost Vacuum plus Prime Catcher. That is a combination that Nico needs in the upcoming turn. However, we now see the Mawile change.
And hold on, Tempting Trap getting played. Ooh, if Nico had either piece there, either the Lost Vacuum or the Prime Catcher, this would have been all over, but it looks like Lucas is just trying to slowly buy time to make that Palpad plus boss's orders play. So Lucas understands, no need to open that bench space up. Don't give my opponent the opportunity to bench that last Iron Crowns, which would get him across the finish line if he had something like Lost Vacuum potentially.
I don't know if I saw Lost Vacuum in there, but there can't be too many cards in Nico's deck at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And he does have a Professor's Research, so we generally could see this. But if Nico doesn't find the combination and only finds one of the pieces, maybe Airy could be his undoing.
Yeah, or just the combination of Palpad plus boss to search it out with the quick search.
Yeah.
So I think he's just debating, do I take the safer route, grab maybe one of the pieces, and then for next turn go for that? But you can't hold on to that, because if Lucas is not winning, then it changes the entire situation of this game. Smart attachment here, put that onto the Maridon, make sure that it can pivot out. And I think we may be trying to spin the wheel here potentially. I feel like if you're not hitting these pieces, it is just primed to put yourself into a very sketchy situation. And
there's a Lost Vacuum, which you
vacuum.
Can play, right?
Okay.
The Lost Vacuum you can play, and it cannot be aerated. That will get rid of the Heroescape right here, send it to the Lost Zone, and yeah, then it's going to come down to research next turn. The boss is still right here. Can Lucas have Palpat and boss's orders in his hand for this upcoming turn? I don't think he had the Palpad.
I don't think so. I think had to use that quick search the previous turn to grab the penny to make sure that the game wasn't ended at this point.
And you so, have to wonder if just attacking with Charizard last turn would have been a little better, then Lucas would be winning this turn, right? Or would have applied that pressure to Nico.
Oh, but found the Luminion. That's a huge card. That means that Palpad can put back this boss's orders, and then Luminion's Luminous Sign ability. Well, boss's orders, one of these two prize Pokemon up.
Wow.
Very close there at the end for Lucas. It seemed like things could have slipped back into Nico's court. But it will be Lucas Zing winning game one, putting himself one game away from advancing to top four.
What a top deck by Lucas. And now, Nico, that one prize card that he chose not to take, his Iron Hands went down anyway. Perhaps he didn't expect the Defiance banned from Lucas, but now he knows. Yeah, so the aggression needs to be there. Just take as many prizes as you can. You know your Pokemon are going to go down just as easily, but it's very important for you to keep up with your opponent.
Oh,
so we'll see how Nico adapts at this point in time.
I was so focused on the different lines of play that the Luminion was just in the hand because of Penny on the previous turn.
Oh, right.
So
right,
I already had that in there. So a little bit of a slip
true.
Up on my end. I thought he top decked it, but of course he had it in the hand.
No, you're absolutely right. Yeah, we saw the Penny pick up that Luminion. You are completely right. So Lucas was ready.
But that was still so close, especially after a double generator hit going second. If that Mimikyu isn't in the active spot, this could be a completely different game. Or if Nico even had just a way to use a techno radar, any way to get Iron Bundle down, I think that game is all Nico from there on.
Yeah, for sure. Even if he just goes, like, he should have tried to go for the research, right? He knew that the Luminion was in hand. He knew he could quick search. His opponent could quick search for the Palpat. So just going for the research, trying to get the win that turn would have been the way to go. But as it turns out, Nico was able to take a few prizes here and there, got to that three prize point, which was very important. Now, this choice by Lucas, perhaps he was trying to avoid precisely that, that Iron Hands with the tool and the four Iron Crowns to knock out a Hero Caped Pidgeot, and that is why he chose to go after the Iron Hands that didn't have the tool card attached to it.
Things all worked out there for Lucas, all thanks to that Luminous Sign ability from Lumineon. Was able to just get across the finish line, and you see, Lumineon, definitely a frail Pokemon. It's got a lot of weaknesses, especially against Ampu very much for three prizes. But if you can maneuver around, know when to bench the card, know when it's worth it. And of course, took that threat off the board the previous turn and then had an option to use Boss's Orders thanks to the quick search, searching out the Palpat.
Yeah, very well played by both players. We'll have to see if either player does some adaptation. Two rare candies prized for Lucas. He's going to be very happy that he's playing a third once he checks his prizes.
Yeah, but even just having one of those two, or even having both of those, is just so unfortunate since because you're only playing three copies of rare candy, it means you can't rare candy your Pidgeot and rare candy your Charizard. So this could mean that Lucas maybe has to try and go this game without playing Pidgeot EX, but that does not seem like a great strategy, but it might just be what you have to do to keep up with the aggression that Iron Hands EX puts on your opponent's Pokemon.
Now, I'm pretty sure Lucas just checked some of his prizes. I don't know if rare candies are the first pieces you check. I think the 1-1 Charizard line is the first thing you would check, so we'll have to see if he even checks for that or if he finds out the wrong way later down the line. Now, over on Nico's side, he would not be happy that the Mimikyu was the Pokemon that was started once again. That's very annoying for him to deal with. Has to commit to the Mirrodin in order to deal with it. And, of course, he's not getting an extra prize card because of it. So, now Lucas being a little more thorough with his prize checking, and I'm sure he's going to be aware that there's two rare candies not available.
So will be Rotom coming down, so instant charge, a great way to fill the hand up with a few more cards before this turn ends, as Nico will be still threatening a lot. Going second in this position, you can use that peak acceleration on turn one if you get lucky like he did in the previous game. Could also go for an Ampu very much, and it will be the Charmander coming down. So this signals to me, at least, Pablo, that he is all in on this solo Charizard and maybe hoping to eventually get one of those rare candy off the prize cards into hand and from there establish Pidgeot for the late game.
Yep, that's going to be very, very good for him. We'll have to see what the instant charge gets him. And now it's on Nico, right, to start the aggression, start the pressure. He sees no Pidgey in play, and that's something that's going to be very good news. But wow, Top Deck the Prime Catcher, that's not a card you want to see this early in the game.
Not at all, and contrary to game one, this hand is looking extremely solid. Prime Catcher, multiple supporters, and Techno Radar, plus some energy cards, means that no matter how Nico plays this, he is going to have a stellar first turn at this point.
Now that Radar going for that decent start. Will he be able to piece out the knockout on the Mimikyu?
I'm thinking maybe there's a world where you just play something like the Prime Catcher at this point and go after Charmander.
Possibly.
It's sort of a double-edged sword because having that piece is your way sort of out of the Mimikyu stall. So I'm not sure. Maybe Nico has a sense that because Pidgey was not the first Pokemon to come down, that Lucas may not have the pieces he wants to play his normal strategy in this game. So I'm really curious to see what Nico decides to do on this first turn.
Yeah, and not only the Mimikyu stall, but also the Mawile stall for sure. That's the only switching card he has available. We don't know if Lucas knows that, but Nico must know that. And now he saw the Mawile from the previous game, right? So he must be very aware of that. He needs to be very careful with what he benches, and he needs to be very careful with the timing of that Prime Catcher.
So it'll be the attachment and the booster energy coming down onto this Mirrodin, and there is another booster energy capsule on to this Iron Hands EX. And this is just the question for Nico. Are you content just taking this knockout? I think even considering just playing another Techno Radar. So just wants to maybe get another Iron Hands EX into play. Maybe have that be the one he powers up, since that can have a tool card like the Heavy Baton to give it a little bit more protection and to keep those energy cards in play.
Now, in order to get a knockout on the Mimikyu, he does need to commit another Iron Crown into play. It seems like Nico's not going to do that. He knows how big of a liability it can be having two of them. And now it's going to come down to the Iron Bundle. Yeah. Oh, there it is. There's a kill. Yeah. Sorry, my bad.
Plus 40 damage, so will be 80 from the peak acceleration, taking the knockout onto Mimikyu. And so now for Lucas, with this hand, there's a one prize Pokemon in the active spot. You're relying on finding a lot, but there is Ultra Ball for a Seal Stone in the hand and has the Counter Catcher. If there is a crazy combination of a bunch of these comeback cards, the Defiance Band, which you can only play when you're behind on prize cards, or rather get its effect, the Counter Catcher, which you can only play. So let's see what Lucas has, and this is going to be a huge turn for him, especially since that Iron Hands does not have a Heavy Baton on it. Let's see it, and there it is. There is the Rare Candy plus the Defiance Band, and if there's an Ultra Ball in hand or a Four Seal Stone, those are all the pieces that Lucas needs, and it looks like there is an Ultra Ball here. What a response for Lucas, especially after just going first, benching the Charmander, and using Instant Charge. He's got a response KO on a powered-up Iron Hands EX and can take the prize lead.
Yeah, well, Lucas once again pretending to be a Charizard EX deck, except without Pidgeot this time. But that's going to be fine for him. He's going to be able to take down the first two prizes, have that humongous 330 HP Pokemon. And Nico's going to have to respond to this by going research and losing his Prime Catcher. Whether he plays it or not, it's going to be a different matter. But without the Prime Catcher, I'm sure Lucas is going to catch on to this and might try to shift into Mawile if his resources allow him to do this.
You've got to be wary of that one psychic energy, but if that gets committed, absolutely, Pablo. That's a great strategy to go for. There it is, Counter Catcher, bringing Iron Hands EX up into the active spot, and it feels like deja vu again. Lucas has responded after Nico takes the first prize card and takes the lead, but those two Rare Candy are still in the prize cards. With how things look right now, may be able to draw it if another prize is taken. And we're going to see the bundle come down. And Nico's just wondering, am I really just going to have to lose this Prime Catcher? And just has to lose it. And it looks like, unfortunately for Nico there, went to go draw seven cards, and one of the cards from his deck flipped over and revealed itself to both of these players. So there may be a slight pause here as we try to figure things out. You hate to see it in a situation like this, but we'll figure out how things go.
Yeah, now, that was a very unfortunate accident for sure. We'll have to see how this gets resolved. There are the seven cards off of that professor's research. Now, of course, none of these cards have any merit to being shuffled just yet, right? So that information getting revealed. It's just going to be a warning. It seems we are getting confirmation on that. Very genuine, small mistake. Yeah, yeah. No big deal. It's no surprise that Nico is playing Lightning Energy, right? A bunch of them. So yeah. I think it's fair to just give a warning.
And we want to see a great game. I'd hate to see such an important game like this be decided by prize penalties. So Nico will play this research, but does get rid of that Prime Catcher. And that means really another Iron Crowns isn't safe to come down onto the board because there's only one copy of Psychic Energy. So we'll see. Nico has full information that there are... It is a trapping strategy in this deck with Mawile, so let's see what he decides to do. Can just grab these and put them into the hand. These cards off the Techno Radar are just grabbed, put to the hand. Cobalt Command will boost this Maridon. Can do 80 damage again, but from there, you've got to wonder if Lucas just plays another boss's orders or even just takes this one prize knockout. Nico still has got to map his way to take these last five prize cards, especially with Lucas just having this Charizard in play and there being really no great one prize Pokemon to target on Nico's side if he had something like a Counter Catcher this turn.
Now, if Nico gets two energies, which he does, I think the Arm Press is just going to be a much better strategy that does set up the two-hit KO on the Charizard EX. Charizard EX now, the Defiance Band not working properly, so Iron Hand surviving with 20 HP left. I think that Electric Generator just gave Nico the best possible play he had here.
That's how the great Pokemon separate themselves. You play cards, you see different options, and it really just allows you to adjust your strategy. And so we're going to be seeing a two-hit knockout thanks to that Future Booster Energy Capsule and the Cobalt Command ability. And now Lucas feels like it has just been a complete swing of momentum. Felt like the ball was just in Lucas's court. That big electric generator has now shifted things. And even if you play something like Boss's Orders, you're not developing your board at all. You've got to ask yourself, sure, I go down to two prize cards, but what's my play from there? If my opponent puts down even another Iron Crowns, they could go amp you very much into knockout or try and amp this Rotom to end the game off. So let's see here. Lucas hasn't even used his Forest Seal Stone yet, so this could be a situation where he either starts to just buy himself some time or try and set something up, and it's going to just be that Radiant Charizard, so maybe even just preparing to have to get that powered up and attacking in the following turns.
Now, there is a funny play that Lucas can make here. He can Lost Vacuum his own Defiance Band and attach the Heroescape, and that would put the Charizard EX out of range of another Arm Press unless Nico commits two more Iron Crowns, which might be exactly what Lucas wants, given that he has access to this Mawile. So very quirky play for sure. It could be some sort of trap. Would Nico fall for it? I don't think so.
It's going to be a tough choice of what you want to Lost Zone here. All three other cards in your hand are such good options. You can't get rid of that Heroescape. That's too valuable. So then it comes down to, do you get rid of Penny from your hand? Do you get rid of the Pal Pad, which is so crucial to put Boss back in? Or do you get rid of Super Rod, which if your Mawile or Charizard get knocked out, then you have no access to that for the rest of the game. So we'll see what Lucas decides to get rid of, what he values the least out of the cards in the hand if he does go for that play.
Now, if Nico is able to amp you very much the Charizard, combine that with an Iono, that would be super, super powerful. Hitting for 210 feels really bad here because then your follow-up is Radiant Charizard, but you really don't want to deal 250 damage to a Pokemon that has 20 HP left.
And even if Nico just takes two prizes on this, the Radiant Charizard would need the help of something like Magma Basin. We're just going to see an instant charge to end the turn. That means no damage applied to this Iron Hands, and Nico has been gifted two more prize cards in this situation. You've got to always ask yourself, is this a trap? What is my opponent cooking? But it's definitely a lot less when Pidgeot EX is not established and on the board.
I think if Nico had a backup Iron Hands EX, there would be no hesitation at this point in time, but that Radiant Charizard looking very, very difficult and very difficult to take down.
So now comes decision time for Nico. Do you invest benching more of these Iron Crowns? Or hold on, we're going to see the Hyper Blower from this Iron Bundle. So now Lucas has a decision. What does he want to bring up into the active? It feels like Radiant Charizard is just the best choice. Your opponent has to commit too much, but it looks like we're just burning cards at this point. So a little bit of a psych, maybe giving some false hope to Lucas, saying, really? You're not going to knock my Charizard out? Okay, that's fine. But here we go. We're going to see the Booster Energy Capsule, and we're just going to be seeing...
It's going to be Iono.
And yeah, here we go. So Iono puts it down to four cards, but we didn't see the Iron Crowns get benched, so it could just be the Arm Press. And I actually think this play is good because getting yourself not into Charizard range easily, or Radiant Charizard rather, may just be worth the prize card in the moment if it means you just can get an extra turn to do what you'd like.
I mean, Nico does have the option, though. Amp You Very Much is doing enough. It's right now doing 160 damage.
Oh, that's
true. And there was
true.
No Heroescape. So
yeah.
Nico does have that option, does put him very vulnerable. Now, pretty sure Lucas's plan was to penny up the Rotom, get the fire energy from there, and attach it to the Radiant Charizard. But as it stands, getting a fire energy might be quite difficult for Lucas.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to see Amp You Very Much. So lots of math involved, getting closer to win. That Iron Hands in the prize card, I'm sure would have liked to have that as a backup option. But here we go. What does Lucas have access to? I see Lumineon. That's an impactful card. Immediately going to play that down. Use the Luminous Sign ability.
Penny.
What piece does it have? And it's the Penny in the hand. That is a big time find. That energy being put on the Rotom seemed to be disguised as just a pivoting option has now come back to assist Lucas to take this knockout. And this was sort of one of the fears that I had about making a play where you just put yourself into single attachment range onto that Radiant Charizard.
Yeah, Nico doesn't have a backup. Iron Hands, no energy in play other than on that Rhydon, who's going to do 80 damage, but that's not really as significant. Now, he does have an Iono, and I'm pretty sure he has another Iron Hands in his hand. So if he can attack into the Charizard, put it in range of an Amp You Very Much, and Iono Lucas down to two prize cards or two cards in hand, how do you recover from that? I think Lucas needs to bench the Rotom here once again if he wants to stand a chance.
I can't tell which future Pokemon that is, Pablo. The full arts, they look so similar to each other. You better hope that it is not Iron Hands, because that would shift the entire dynamic of this matchup. Lucas goes down to two prize cards with that Combustion Blast. Now, Radiant Charizard cannot attack next turn. We're just going to be playing cards from our hand, it seems like. That Heavy Baton, having no use on that Mew. It's not like it would have a lot of use normally, since two prize cards would just grant Lucas the victory in this second game of our top eight series. So now Nico's got to think about what he wants to go for. And this attachment here really signals that there may not be any more Iron Hands EX in the deck. It's just going to be an Iono. Maybe a peak acceleration that will set this Radiant Charizard up for a two-hit knockout. But yes, Lucas has put the two cards, and maybe that Rotom coming down, like you mentioned, could have given him a little bit more leeway in a situation like this.
Now, could we see a way for Iron Crown to take down this Pidgey? Is that going to be Nico's last prize card? I would not be surprised if that happens.
Yeah, also powering up the Maridon to be able to potentially attack. I think it's just thinking about, where do you want to put these energy cards? Is it worth getting them into play? I definitely like the one energy Iron Crowns. Now that would set some math up, especially if the Charizard stays active, right? If that doesn't evolve, while your Cobalt Command ability does not increase the damage for Iron Crowns itself, that Booster Capsule does do that, and that would be the math needed to take a knockout. Actually, you would be just short of this Charizard. It would be 10 damage off, so this could be tough. Let's see how things play out here. What does Lucas have access to?
A Buffin, an Entei, and a Ballpad. So not great cards and no Rotom to draw. So it's looking dire. Radiant Charizard also can't attack since it just attacked last turn. And we see the pass by Lucas.
But there's not much in hand either for Nico.
But he doesn't need much, right? 80 damage, knock out the Radiant Charizard, has a Psychic in hand, which he's choosing not to attach. I really don't like that. I wish he would just leave the Iron Crown ready to snipe the Pidgey in case of an Iono or something.
So Entei V comes up into the active spot. Gotta make sure the deck is shuffled at this point. Gotta make sure we're following what the cards do. And this might be a big Fleet-Footed. What are we gonna see here? I can't tell if that was the draw for turn or the Fleet-Footed ability. It's so close between these players. Nico almost here at pulling this game back after such a strong start from Lucas. Does still have access to that Palpad and will play this Palpad right now. So we'll see the Penny come back into the deck. That's it. And the question here is, if there is that Fleet-Footed, is there a one chance opportunity for you to maybe find something like the Penny? You give yourself a little bit more time. You can sit here with the Entei and Fleet-Footed. But no, there's nothing. It's just going to be a pass of the turn.
That's going to be the game. Psychic energy to the Iron Crown will be able to take down that Pidgey four game. And we're going to a game three here.
Wow, so back and forth. But Nico, despite not having access to that last Iron Crown's EX, was able to put together a strategy to close that game out. And we are going the distance. This is going to be an exciting third game between both Nico and Lucas.
Turns out, even if you don't have Switch cards, right, when there's only Mawile as an option, you don't mind that too much. And it seems like the crowd really rooting for Nico right here. Now, we do have some updates from the floor in terms of who else and what is going on with our top eight. Do you want to update us, Ethan?
Yeah, I'd love to. Things have gone pretty much as we thought they would. The two dynamic matchups have already finished. Zane has beat Abon, that of course being Lugia V-Star heading to top four, taking down Control. And then at the same time, Brandon playing Lugia, taking down Snorlax 2-0. So we're going to be having two Lugia V-Star already in the top four.
Yeah, and Reagan being up one turn, it seems like the Control legs are in danger. But did see a fantastic game two here. We saw Nico play really, really well. And Lucas, with that unfortunate 2 for a candy prize, had the early Charizard response, but did not have access to Pidgeot at all. And that's when your Pidgeot Control deck tends to fall apart.
Yeah, Charizard can only get you so far if you don't have ways to search out cards or even things like Barrel separate in that situation if there was that card. But of course, Lucas has committed more cards to just playing this Control style. Was so close towards the end there. Let's take a look at these prize cards, see how important these are. You don't want to get any important cards prized. There is one copy of Rare Candy as well as one copy of Iron Hands for Nico. But I think here we are going to have an excellent, exciting match. This time, Lucas choosing to go second in a very smart play. Sometimes going first, not bad with this Control style deck, but it's more so that you know how much this Iron Hands, Iron Crowns deck can threaten when it goes second on the first turn.
Now, I really like this pigeon control approach because obviously one of the big weaknesses in Top Cut is the time, right? But when you have a 1-1 Charizard EX and the Radiant Charizard and the Entei that can really provide some aggression to the deck, maybe the time doesn't end up factoring against you. So very good adaptation. There's still plenty of time left in this round. And these matches have gone by very quickly, but I generally don't know who to give the advantage to. Both players have been very close. Both matches have been very close for both players. Yeah, that Prime Catcher being so clutch for Nico, but how? Like, what will determine this game three?
I think it's going to come down to how fast Lucas gets that set up. He's had responses every single game. In turn two, turn three, Charizard, very, very strong starts. But it really felt like the opportunity where Nico could have maybe taken that extra prize card could have changed the entire dynamic. So I feel like Nico, with now having more list information, knowing what he could have done better in that first game that he lost, but at the same point, if Lucas just gets Pidgeot set up and can maybe get it one turn sooner on that Charizard with Defiance Band, we know those pieces are still in the deck. They are not in the prize cards. How will things change? How will things play out? Time will tell, but Buddy Poffin is a great way for Lucas to start this turn off and get both Pidgey and Charmander into play.
Now, Lucas is going to be very happy to see that he has two rare candies available to have that Pidgeot aggression, but also, I mean, that Pidgeot setup, but also the access to the Charizard aggression, which was so, so important in that first game. Nico still had an opportunity if he had gone for that research and found both cards, right? The Lost Vacuum and the Prime Catcher, but that Charizard EX is just such a big threat against Iron Hands.
It looks like Lucas may have another Buddy Poffin in the hand, too. This is an advantage to maybe getting another Pidgey down, but it is in the prize card. So normally you'd like to just give yourself a little bit more flexibility if one of those pieces does get targeted down. But we are just going to immediately see Mawile as the selection off of Nest Ball. And then with the shuffle of the deck, you've got to wonder, does Lucas have anything else, or will he be relying off Grasping Draw to fill the hand up and give himself more options in terms of what he can do on the following turn?
No, it doesn't seem like, it seems like Lucas has identified that he's only seen Prime Catcher, right, as a way to switch. He has not seen anything else. So he might try to be a little more aggressive with Amoel, force Nico to expend resources, get energy onto the board, and then hit him with a return KO with Charizard plus an Iono to deplete Nico's field, because Nico cannot afford to bench too many Pokemon or have too much backup because of the threat of the Mawile's tempting trap.
And speaking of which, Lucas did find energy cards here. Pablo, is this an opportunity where you don't use Grasping Draw and just try and go for the tempting trap on this Iron Crowns?
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, force your opponent to power it up manually. Finding that one copy of Psychic Energy is just not going to be easy, right? It could generally be the last card in the deck, and you have no way to directly search for it. And do you really want to commit your Prime Catcher to bring up your Mirrodin and find that Psychic? Probably not.
Yeah, I guess it depends here on this generator, because turn two, Prime Catcher, knock out the only Charmander in play. That wouldn't be a bad play at all. You make sure that threat of Charizard is not necessarily on the board, only getting one energy off this electric generator. So I think the choice here for Nico is going to depend on what other supporter cards were found off this Iono. Did have access to Professor's Research and that Iono the previous turn. Not sure there's something like Arvin to specifically grab out that one Prime Catcher item card. So may have to rely on finding even something as simple as a pivoting card, but that doesn't work in this case because of Tempting Trap. So we'll see what resources Nico is willing to give up if he is going to play this research and where he wants to put these tool cards like the Future Booster Energy Capsule.
And now usually the difference between Mawile and Snorlax is that with Boss's Orders, you can't get out of the Snorlax block ability, right? However, Mawile doesn't need to be in the active during your opponent's turn for the effect to remain. So that's one big advantage and one of the reasons why players use Mawile over Snorlax, because the effect is technically permanent until the end of your opponent's next turn.
And there are no switching cards, no Prime Catcher in this hand. So this may have bought Lucas a little bit of time to just set up, use Tempting Trap, and if there's something like Rare Candy Pidgeot, you just slowly grab those cards to your hand until you can make a big combo play. So Lucas is being given a little bit of time in this spot, finds that Lumineon V, and I believe there was a Rare Candy in the hand. So now it's on Lucas to decide where he wants to go from here. Do we shift to a full trapping strategy at this point, or are we looking to just slowly build up a big board where we've got our Charizard EX, we can knock out the Iron Crowns. Let's not forget that Iron Crowns does have Dark Weakness, so if Lucas really wants to, he could, if he finds Rare Candy Pidgeot, Rare Candy Charizard, take a two-prize knockout, and then from there, try and just put on aggression for the rest of the game.
Yeah, that turn to Charizard. Once again, this Pidgeot control, putting on its disguise as a Charizard deck, that aggression so, so clutch. And I'm pretty sure that's part of the reason why it's so difficult to play against this deck, right? Mm-hmm. You need to factor in all the control cards and all the resources they have to do that, but you also need to factor in that your Pokemon can go down, because usually, for example, against something like Snorlax, you can just power up one Pokemon, and if that can deal with Mimikyu and that can deal with Snorlax, you're fine. But you are not safe against these Charizard decks.
So we'll be that Rare Candy. I believe Lucas may just be going back into the deck unless he wants to just continue to use Tempting Trap for a little bit longer and wait to put that Charizard EX into play until the proper turn. So we're just going to see another Tempting Trap. So Lucas is waiting and holding on until seeing something specific coming into play on the turn, or until Nico maybe commits a certain card like that Prime Catcher, or commits a card like the Psychic Energy to one of these Iron Crowns.
Now, there's the Prime Catcher being eyed up, so that's going to be the resource fully gone for Nico, the only way to retreat, which I think Lucas has identified now. He could potentially use Iron Bundle, send the Mawile to the bench, and then play the Prime Catcher to take it down and make it harder to use it again, but decides to eliminate the one Charmander, which does delay the Charizard EX response, but I'm pretty sure Lucas is going to be happy to counter catcher up this Iron Crown once again to the active, and then just super up the Charmander back to the bench and eventually set up that Charizard EX.
Yeah, and I have to remember the interaction that something like Defiance Vest has with the effect on Iron Crown, since Iron Crown EX technically goes through all effects on your opponent's Pokemon. I believe that would still go through the Defiance Vest, so I mean, if you can put some Psychic Energies onto this Iron Crowns, yes, trapping it means it's not doing a one-hit knockout, but slowly it starts chipping away at this Mawile, and you can't penny it over and over again forever.
Yeah, and it seems like Nico very well registering that option, will attach that Psychic Energy, and now the Iron Crown is also a threat on the board. I generally don't know what's going to happen. Yeah, what are Lucas's options? What are Nico's options? I mean, Nico's plan is pretty straightforward, right? Beat down, attack, do as much damage as possible. I think Lucas at this point has to just go back, make sure he sets up the Charizard EX, and go for that aggressive route. Trapping the Iron Crown, no longer a viable plan, and there's nothing like Erika's invitation to potentially trap another Iron Crown that doesn't have any energy attached to it.
I think this is okay for Lucas. He can just take some time here. Play something like the Counter Catcher onto the Iron Hands EX that has no energy on it. And from there, since the only way to gust out of the active spot, Prime Catcher is gone, you are essentially given at minimum three turns. So if you can then from there find something like the Super Rod to bring back that Charmander, your opponent can play Boss's Orders. Sure, bring up one of my Pokemon, but your guy is going to be stuck here. He's not going to be moving, and you're going to be down that resource later on in the game.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if you have Free Retreat, if you are immediately trapped by that Tempting Trap that will give Lucas so much time to put the Charmander back into the deck, eventually evolve into Charizard EX. Now, there is merit to letting Nico take one more prize card, right? Because then that allows Charizard EX to make sure it always one-KOs the Iron Hands no matter what. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it can get a little bit scary since you can possibly set math up that you wait to knock out the Cleffa and the Mawile the same turn with the Iron Crowns. And then from there, it means that Ampu very much on Pidgeot can change things up. So we'll see this bring up the Iron Crowns. And here we go, trapping away. That Iron Crowns, or rather the Iron Hands, is not going anywhere. It's manual attachment time here. We're slowing things down a little bit.
Now, Nico definitely plays enough energy to power up this Iron Hand, eventually power up the Iron Crown as well. But, yeah, that's going to give so much time for Lucas to prepare and formulate a game plan to either win by controlling Nico or just taking over the game with a single Charizard EX plus the Radiant Charizard aggression.
And even just valuing not playing Professor's Research this turn, you've kind of hit your quota. All you need is that attachment for turn, and there's lots of powerful tool cards and even cards like Counter Catcher that could be useful throughout the latter of the game. And think Lucas has got a good opportunity here to reestablish this Charmander. You do have to play your one Super Rod, but I feel like now is a better time than not. You've got to get Charizard EX established. That's going to be the best way for you to win this game, or maybe not. We're seeing another counter catcher get grabbed, so maybe I'm missing something here, and there isn't any way right now with how the hand is shaping to play something like a Super Rod, but I feel like getting that Charizard EX is going to be the way that you maybe get yourself back in this game.
Yeah, and this is the one turn where Charmander is safe, right? Because if Nico gets a second energy onto this Iron Hands, then if you bench the Charmander, it could get boss KO'd. And all of a sudden, you're in a little bit more danger. But wow, we see the Thornton.
That's a better way to do it, especially if you don't have to play a supporter card this turn. You might as well save your Super Rod for later. So Thornton's surprising me like it does every time. And we're actually going into this Charmander, which means we can just play Rare Candy Charizard and knock out this Iron Hands EX. Take the Mawile out of play. That's no longer going to be something for an Ampu very much later on. And we can even target down this Iron Hands. The Defiance Band is here, and the Forest Seal Stone can grab the Lost Vacuum out of the deck and remove the Heavy Baton. Meaning that next turn, it's going to take a lot for Nico to power up another Iron Crowns, or rather another Iron Hands EX. A huge combo turn here for Lucas. Thornton allowing it to happen from out of nowhere.
Wow, that Thornton really took us by surprise, Ethan. And I'm pretty sure Nico must be taken aback by this as well. We hadn't seen the Thornton, right, in either of the previous two games.
Yep.
Not sure if it had been revealed before, but Thornton coming in so, so clutch. Not a card we see commonly hit the board.
And that research not being played the previous turn means that now Nico is locked into playing that as a supporter card for turn. Can't gust up something like the Cleffa, maybe take a prize card on that or set some math up elsewhere. It's going to be pretty much locked into using this peak acceleration to try and repower that Iron Hands up. But it's really scary from here because you're going to have your only Iron Crowns in play, be susceptible to a boss's orders the following turn. And the problem is, you are reasonably capped out at 80 damage this turn. If you bench another Iron Crowns, it can get Tempting Trap and you will lose the game. So that is off the table here for Nico. But at the same time, if you can't bench more Iron Crowns, you can't boost your damage. And even with 80 damage, you would have to deal at minimum with the 20 damage intervals, 260 damage to take the knockout. And that is just not
impossible.
Possible. Yeah. Even without benching four, you could bench four Iron Crowns.
And the booster capsule, and then
but
you
that's
would
just
have
losing.
Enough. Yeah.
So let's see what Nico can do. And even going to put Mew EX into play, I mean, that can draw you some cards. Restart is a great ability, but things now get scary with double boss's orders to close the game out. Nico's going to do all he can here to fight for his tournament life and play what he can to keep himself alive here at the Los Angeles Regionals.
Now, funnily enough, Lucas didn't even need the Defiance Band because of the effect of Tempting Trap giving you extra damage during your next turn. I mean, there's no reason not to play that down unless you want to attach a Heroescape perhaps to your Charizard EX. So perhaps a small oversight. But I think it's easy to forget that Tempting Trap has that secondary effect of the bonus damage.
That is a good point. We'll see if that comes back to impact Lucas later on in this game. If you kind of just put that on the Charizard, it'd just be a lot harder for it to knock it out. But again, with how the damage works, I'm not sure it will be extremely relevant. But time will tell, Pablo. Time will tell, as it looks like Research will be the final card played. I mean, you kind of have to get rid of some valuable resources like Countercatcher potentially. But with the way the prize mapping works, I'm not sure Countercatcher really changes a whole lot, since how it's going to work most likely, sure, you can knock this Cleffa out if you really want to. I guess it's going to be going after the Pidgeot, so this could do a little bit of chip damage and set up for an Ampu very much later on. But is that really worth it here in this situation when you're going to still have to find that Gusting card later on and there's a high chance your counter catchers are slowly going to be discarded or they just won't be able to be used at all?
And, I mean, you have enough damage for Ampu very much with both the Iron Crown and your tool card, right? Mm-hmm. So this really puzzles me. I feel like either taking a knockout on the Cleffa to get that extra prize card or just attacking into the Charizard, dealing as much damage as possible. 80 damage on the Pidgeot doesn't seem super relevant at this point in time. But we'll have to see what Nico is planning.
Been some surprising plays from both these players, putting on an absolute show for us. See how this game concludes. Now, Lucas has not played that boss's orders yet, and I actually think we haven't even seen any Palpat hit the discard pile, and that is a great top deck there. Top decks the Palpat, so if Lucas wants to here, Cert can search out the boss's orders and then play the Palpat in his hand, which means as long as Quick Search is available next turn, he can find the final boss's orders to close this game out. Let's see what he decides to do.
Did Quick Search for that boss. We're going to start with the aggression. Palpat back to boss is one Quick Search away from knocking out this Mew EX next turn. How can Nico respond to this? How can he stop this Charizard EX from stomping through his field? I don't think he can, Ethan.
It's looking very, very dark. Tunnel is closing in. The doors are closing for Nico. His tournament life is on the line. Even just putting a Mist Energy onto this Lumineon to make sure that it can retreat next turn. Lucas Zing going down to two prize cards left, and it's on Nico here. What can he put together with this hand? Plenty of cards, some hand disruption, but hand disruption is futile when Pidgeot EX can just search that boss's orders out. It's looking very, very dark. Lucas Zing in a prime position to advance to top four.
Yep, even has the counter catcher to potentially take down the Pidgeot, but then how are you doing that? With Iron Hands and then Charizard EX just takes you down. So I don't think there's any way for Nico to stop this Charizard EX from taking him down next turn. You knock out the Pidgeot, you're doomed. You don't knock out the Pidgeot, you're also doomed.
And you can't trap anything because now there's that Mist Energy on the Lumineon. Yep. So even something like an Iono to buy yourself a turn would not work because both of those Pokemon, the Kleffa and the Pidgeot, have zero retreat costs. They can move in and out of the active spot as they please.
What are Nico's options here? I don't know what he can potentially do. He's eyeing up this counter catcher, but that Pidgeot not in range of the Mirrodin, so does bring up the Pidgeot EX. Can take through prizes. Yeah, that's as close as he's gonna get to the KO. Gonna do maximum damage with Ampu very much, and Lucas Zing will advance to top four.
He's back in another top four. Lucas Zing on a roll this season, and he gets it done with control featuring that Charizard EX. Wow, what a set there for Lucas. Played very, very well. Surprised us with his great usage of Charizard EX at that point. It was a Pidgeot EX control deck. There was tons of Quick Search there, but Charizard, that 101 line, was the MVP.